6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello, this is 6 Minute English from BBC Learning English. I'm Sam.
And I'm Neil. Sam, do you remember an old children's television show called Lassie?
Yes, I grew up watching the adventures of schoolboy Timmy and his pet dog, a collie named Lassie. Whenever Timmy got lost or into trouble, Lassie sensed danger and came to the rescue.
If you believe shows like Lassie, pets know when their human owners feel afraid or in danger. But in real life, do animals know or care about human feelings?
Now, Neil, obviously we're not talking about wild animals, right?
We're talking about domesticated animals. Types of animals which are under human control and have been living closely with people for centuries. They include pets, like cats and dogs, working animals and farm animals, like cows and sheep.
So, what about dogs like our friend Lassie? Do you think they can sense human feelings?
It's hard to know what's really going on behind a dog's big brown eyes. Unlike humans, pets can't talk to say how they're feeling, and this makes it easy for us to misunderstand them. People often anthropomorphize their pets, treat them as if they were human by giving them human characteristics.
In cartoons, Mickey Mouse can talk and Donald Duck dances and sings, but we know mice and ducks don't really do that in nature.
Exactly, but recently, new research has suggested that sometimes pets do respond to their owners' feelings.
Okay, well, before we find out more, I have a quiz question for you, Neil. Lassie wasn't the only TV show to feature a boy and his pet companion. A similar show, Skippy, was set in Australia. But what type of animal was the star? Was Skippy A, a rabbit, B, a frog, or C, a kangaroo?
Well, if Skippy was Australian, I'll guess he's C, a kangaroo.
Okay, I'll reveal the answer later in the programme. Now, Neil, earlier you mentioned that because animals can't speak, it's difficult to know their feelings about us.
Difficult, yes, but not impossible. Recently, anthrozoologist Dr. Karen Hiestand designed an experiment to test whether our pets really do care about us. She filmed pet owners pretending to be hurt and observed the reactions of their dogs and cats.
Here's Adrian Washbourne, producer for BBC World Service programme Health Check, pretending to hurt his leg at home, where he lives with his two pets, a cat and a dog.
And now I'm going to fake an injury, and we'll see how they respond. Ah! Ow! Ooh! Well, the tail wagging has got a bit more. There's a bit of a yawn, so I don't think they were particularly sensitive or bothered that I was squealing around the floor in agony, holding my leg up in the air, trying to feign an injury. Meanwhile, the cat, who's on the windowsill, is looking at me with wide eyes.
Adrian didn't really hurt his leg. He feigned or pretended to be hurt. He pretended to be in agony, extreme physical pain, to see what his pets would do.
Adrian's dog wagged his tail and gave a yawn. The cat, meanwhile, just looked at him with wide eyes. Little evidence of pets showing care or concern there, you might think. But according to Dr. Hiestand, the animal's behaviour makes perfect sense when you remember where they came from. Dogs are descended from ancient breeds of wolves, very social animals who live together in packs. So it makes sense that a dog would sniff and come closer to investigate what was happening.
Cats, on the other hand, are solitary creatures, descended from wild cats who lived and hunted alone. Dr. Hiestand thinks this explains the reaction of Adrian's cat, as she told BBC World Service programme Health Check.
What we're seeing typically is cats staying much more still, that they're looking and looking at their owner. So they're definitely paying their owner an awful lot of attention when they're displaying this sort of negative distress emotion, compared to during the control procedure where they're just doing cat things, walking around, grooming, that kind of thing.
The experiment showed the different responses of cats and dogs to human distress, feelings of worry, sadness or pain.
In the experiment, dogs were visibly concerned, while cats simply paid more attention to what was going on. Some cats did nothing except carry on grooming, cleaning themselves using their tongue and paws.
The experiment confirms the idea we have of cats being cold and antisocial.
And of dogs being our best friend. But according to Dr. Hiestand's findings, cats also feel human distress. They just show it in a different way.
Well, if the experiment included Lassie, she'd probably phone the emergency services and make Adrian a cup of tea.
Ha, and what about Skippy?
Aha, yes. In my quiz question, I asked Neil about the Australian TV star Skippy.
I guessed that he was C, a kangaroo.
Which was the correct answer. Over 2 metres high and able to jump 9 metres in a single hop, you'd be in safe hands with Skippy the kangaroo. Right, let's recap the vocabulary from this programme, starting with domesticated, a word to describe animals which are not wild and live under human control.
To anthropomorphise means to give animals human qualities and characteristics.
If you feign illness, you pretend to be ill when you're not.
To be in agony means to be in extreme physical pain.
Someone who's in distress feels worry, pain, or sadness.
And finally, grooming is how some animals clean themselves using their tongue and paws.
That's all the time we have for this programme. Bye for now.
Goodbye.
6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to 6 Minute English. I'm Neil.
Hello, and I'm Catherine.
Now, Catherine, how do you feel about cephalopods?
Cephalopods.
Yeah, you do know what cephalopods are, don't
yes,
you?
Yes, of course I do. It's a new kind of iPod, isn't it?
Not exactly, no. A cephalopod is a kind of sea creature, like a squid or octopus.
Oh, cephalopods. Yes, of course, I know what a cephalopod is.
Of course you do. Well, today's programme is all about one of these squishy creatures, the octopus, which apparently is a pretty clever animal. To start, here's today's quiz question. What is the correct plural form of octopus? Is it A, octopuses, B, octopodes, or C, octopi? What do you think, Catherine?
OK, I think this is a trick question. I think people think that it's octopi, but it's actually, there's a technical term for it, which is the correct term, and that's octopodes. But some people think, like children and stuff, they just put the plural S on, so they say octopuses. So I'm going for answer B, octopodes.
Well, listen out for the answer at the end of the programme, just to see how right or wrong you are. Now, apparently, the octopus is a remarkably intelligent creature. They have the ability to solve some complex problems. And in one famous case, one was even able to predict the result of World Cup football matches.
Oh, yes, Paul the Psychic Octopus. I don't think he was really psychic, though. It was just a publicity stunt by the zoo that had him as a way to promote their zoo.
It may have been a publicity stunt, but he was actually quite accurate. In fact, he correctly predicted the result of 12 matches out of 14. That's 86%. Not bad, hey?
That's amazing. I didn't know he was that good. Anyway, Neil, tell us some more about the octopus.
Well, I'll leave that to Peter Godfrey Smith, philosopher of science and author of Other Minds, The Octopus, the Sea and the Deep Origins of Consciousness. He is quite a fan of our 8 tentacled friends. On the BBC Radio 4 programme Start the Week, he said that humans and the octopus have a common ancestor. This is a term in science which means a creature from which both species evolved, like a very distant relative. How long ago does he say this common ancestor lived?
We got the octopus as a very special evolutionary product. It's an animal that's removed from us by a lot of evolutionary distance. The common ancestor that we share with an octopus lived about 600 million years ago, or actually even a bit longer than that. But it has a large nervous system in a range comparable to vertebrates.
So our common ancestor lived about 600 million years ago, or maybe a little bit longer than that.
And he says that the octopus has a nervous system that is comparable to vertebrates. Comparable means similar to, like, and vertebrates is the term for the group of animals that have a spine or backbone. We humans are examples of vertebrates.
So what Godfrey Smith is saying is that the squishy octopus has a nervous system which has some similarities to our own in that it's quite large.
And a large nervous system is a sign of intelligence. He goes on to talk a bit more about how we might be able to relate to the octopus. He talks about the protean nature of its body. Protean is an adjective which means adaptable or changeable, and the octopus's body is certainly that. Why might that be a problem for us?
The sensory world of an octopus has In some ways, it's recognisable. They're very visual animals. Mm-hmm. They're very sort of taste-oriented animals, and those things make sense to us. But the absence of hard parts, the protean nature of the body, and the sort of extent of the sensitivity makes it a hard thing to think about.
This is interesting, isn't it? So the octopus uses its senses of vision and taste like we do, and this is something we can recognise. But what's tricky for us is that its form is so completely different from ours. The octopus isn't a vertebrate, so it can change its form and its shape very easily.
Yes, we're not used to thinking of soft, squishy things having intelligence. And speaking of intelligence, we've been very careful not to use the plural of octopus so as not to give away the answer to today's quiz question, which was, what is the correct plural form? A, octopuses, B, octopodes, or C, octopi? Catherine, you said?
Well, I said that some people think it's octopuses, a lot of people think it's octopi, but the actual answer is octopodes.
And you are completely right. Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. So let's review today's vocabulary. Cephalopod is the name of the group of animals to which the octopus belongs.
A publicity stunt is something a company might do to grab your attention and promote its products, like claiming an octopus can predict the winner of football matches.
A common ancestor is a distant relative from which two different species evolved.
Comparable to means similar to, and vertebrates are animals that have a spine.
And then finally we had protean. This adjective means adaptable and changeable.
Time now for us to say goodbye, but remember you can find us on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, as well as our website, bbclearningenglish.com. So be sure to check us on one, several, or all of those before joining us again. Goodbye.
Bye.
6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello, this is 6 Minute English from BBC Learning English. I'm Neil.
And I'm Sam. In this programme, we'll be hearing a new story linked to the nature versus nurture debate, not concerning a human, but a rhinoceros.
The extremely rare northern white rhino of East Africa was on the brink of extinction when the second-to-last living male, Sunny, died in 2014, leaving behind two females, Najin and Fatu, the last living creatures of their species.
Conservationists started an artificial breeding program using eggs from the females and sperm from Sunny to produce an embryo, an unborn animal in the very early stages of development.
Recently, there's been a new development in the story, but before we hear more, it's time for my quiz question. The name rhinoceros comes from the ancient Greek, but what exactly does it mean? Is it A, thick skin, B, horned nose, or C, small eye?
Ooh, that's a tricky one because rhinos have all three. Okay, I'll guess A, thick skin.
Okay, Sam, we'll find out later. Now let's get back to the story of those precious northern rhino embryos.
Well, the good news is that so far 5 embryos have been produced. They're being frozen until they can be implanted in southern rhinos, the northern species' more common cousin.
Conservationist Thomas Hildebrand runs the rhino breeding program. He spoke to BBC World Service's Science in Action, who asked him whether the embryos were genetically from the northern species.
Absolutely right. That's no hybrid. That's pure northern white rhino embryos, which were generated with the desired breeding partner, Sunny, who died in 2014. So we have embryos which have a very high quality. There's no inbreeding effect on these embryos. And it is so important to make the next step to transfer these embryos because we can preserve live biological material in liquid nitrogen. But what we can't do, we can't preserve social knowledge. And therefore, we need desperately a calf on the ground so that these two existing northern white rhinos can teach the new calf how to behave as a northern white rhino.
Having genetically pure embryos prevents the birth of hybrids, animals that have been bred from two different species.
It's also important the embryos have no inbreeding, breeding of a young animal from two closely related parents, because this can cause disease.
Fortunately, Thomas and his team have preserved five healthy and genetically pure northern rhino embryos in liquid nitrogen.
But while they can preserve nature, what Thomas's team can't provide is nurture, the social knowledge that a young northern rhino or calf can only learn from other northern rhinos.
And since Najin and Fatu, the last remaining northern rhinos on Earth, are getting old, the race is on to breed a young rhino calf before they die.
The good news for the survival of the northern white rhino is that experiments to implant the delicate embryos in southern rhinos have been successful.
Here's Thomas Hildebrand again, talking about these recent experiments with BBC World Service programme Science in Action.
We will for sure not wait until this pregnancy is completed, because it takes 16 months for a full pregnancy in a rhinoceros. So if this embryo implants, and we can see that in ultrasound, and form a nice placenta, that is the goal for us to proceed with the next step on the northern white rhino embryos.
Normally, it takes 16 months for a female rhino to complete her pregnancy, the state in which a woman or female animal has a baby developing inside her.
But in the case of the northern rhino, the race is on to birth calves who can learn the rhino rules of social behaviour from Auntie Najin and Granny Fatu while they're still alive.
Which is why conservationists are monitoring the pregnancy using ultrasound, a procedure using sound waves to create images of internal body parts, or in this case, growing rhino babies.
It's an unusual episode in the ongoing nature versus nurture debate.
And hopefully a big step towards restoring the northern white rhino population, so that future generations get to see these magnificent creatures with their thick skin, horned nose and...
and small eyes, Neil. So what was the answer to your quiz question?
Yes, I asked you what the name rhinoceros meant. What did you say, Sam?
I guessed it was A, thick skin. Was I right?
Well, rhinos certainly do have thick skin, but their name actually comes from the Greek meaning horned nose.
Well, luckily, I've got a thick skin too, so I won't take it personally. Let's have another look at the vocabulary we've learned, starting with embryo, an unborn animal or human still inside its mother's womb.
A hybrid is an animal or plant that has been bred from two different species.
Inbreeding is when a young animal is born from closely related parents.
A calf is the name for the young of several large mammals, including cows, elephants and whales, as well as rhinos.
Pregnancy means being pregnant or growing a baby inside you.
And finally, ultrasound is used to see internal organs or a baby developing inside a woman.
And that's all from this species-saving edition of 6 Minute English.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello, this is 6 Minute English. I'm Neil. Joining me is Rob.
Hello.
Rob, when we think of Easter, what do we think of?
Chocolate.
Well, yes, chocolate Easter eggs are an obvious symbol of Easter. But there is an animal people often associate with Easter.
Rabbits. Cute, adorable and fluffy. What's not to like about a rabbit?
Well, not everyone is a fan of them. By not a fan of, I mean they don't like them. Some people think they are a pest. But we'll be telling you more about rabbits shortly.
That's good to know. Well, I'll tell you what I am a fan of, and that is your quiz questions. So what are you going to ask me today?
It's all about wild rabbits. In the last rabbit survey in 1995, how many were estimated to exist in the UK? Was it A, 370,500, B, 3,750,000, or C, 37,500,000?
I know rabbits are everywhere in the UK, but not 37 million of them, so I'll go for B, 3,750,000.
Well, you'll have to wait until the end of the programme to find out. But you're right when you say rabbits are everywhere in the UK. It's probably true in other countries too. You could say they are endemic, meaning very common or strongly established in a place or situation.
But are they a typically British wild animal?
They are now, but it's believed they were brought to the country by invaders. Some say the Romans, others the Normans. But they eventually spread across the UK. Victoria Dickinson is author of a book called Rabbit, and she's been telling the BBC Radio 4 programme, Costing the Earth, about what helped them spread.
It was really by the middle of the 17th century when people really started to think about rabbit as being particularly British. And certainly there were more rabbits in Britain than in the rest of Europe. There was a calculation done that there are over 400 villages and towns in Britain with the word warren in their name. So the rabbits were raised in Britain, but they really kept to their warrens until there was the rise of fox hunting. When their predators disappeared, rabbits do what rabbits do best, and they started to multiply and become wild, feral rabbits throughout the land.
So Victoria knows a thing or two about rabbits and said the word warren, used in town and village names, is evidence that they've been in the UK since the mid-17th century. A warren is the area underground where rabbits live, with lots of holes and connected passages.
But today we use the word warren to mean a building or part of a town where there are lots of confusing passageways or streets. It's a kind of place where you get lost.
But it was rabbit warrens where rabbits would live until hunting, particularly fox hunting, was introduced, and that killed many of the rabbit's predators. A predator is an animal that hunts and kills another animal.
Now, Victoria was talking about feral rabbits, so wild rabbits, not the sort people keep as pets in a rabbit hutch. Moving on, I'm interested to know why not everyone loves these cute little creatures. I mean, think of the rabbit characters in the Beatrix Potter stories.
Well, they weren't always well behaved, and Victoria Dickinson spoke to the Costing the Earth programme about this. What word did she use to describe rabbits having the two opposite sides to their character?
The rabbit is a paradoxical animal. It has a lot of faces, if you will. It's both wild and tame. It's timid, but also has its reputation as trickster rabbit, if you think of Peter Cottontail or you think of Brer Rabbits. And I think our relationship with rabbit is the rabbit of the nursery rhyme, the rabbit of childhood, or you think of Peter Rabbit.
She said that rabbits are paradoxical animals. That's the word that describes them having two opposing characteristics.
Yes, we think of them as wild, maybe a trickster, someone who deceives people to get what they want. Like Peter. What a cheeky rabbit.
But we also think of rabbits as tame. We have nursery rhymes about them. Kids have soft, cuddly rabbit toys. I say that they're the perfect symbol for Easter.
OK, Rob, if you say so. But now let me give the answer to the question I set you earlier. In the last survey of rabbits in 1995, how many were estimated to exist in the UK? Was it A, 370,500, B, 3,750,000, or C, 37,500,000? Rob, what did you say?
I said B, 3,750,000.
Well, you're wrong, Rob. A government survey put the population in the UK at 37.5 million, so a lot more. But despite its reputation, a recent survey suggests rabbit numbers in the UK have declined by around 60% over the last 20 years.
That is sad news. But let's cheer ourselves up with a recap of the vocabulary we've discussed today, starting with a fan of.
When someone is a fan of something, they are keen on it. They like it a lot. If you're not a fan of something, you don't like it.
We mentioned endemic, meaning very common or strongly established in a place or situation.
And we talked about a warren, an underground area where rabbits live, but also a building or a part of a town where there are lots of confusing passageways or streets where it's easy to get lost.
A predator is an animal that hunts and kills another animal.
Paradoxical describes things that have two opposing characteristics, making it hard to understand.
And a trickster is someone who deceives people to get what they want.
Well, I'm no trickster. It really has been 6 minutes, so it's time to call it a day. Please join us next time.
Bye for now.
Goodbye.
6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.
Hello, this is 6 Minute English from BBC Learning English. I'm Neil.
And I'm Sam.
In English, there are many expressions which use an adjective to compare humans with animals. For example, you might say she's as busy as a bee.
As hungry as a horse. But you probably won't hear someone say
she's as clever as a chimpanzee.
which is strange because of all the animals, it's our close cousins, chimpanzees, or chimps for short, who are most like us.
Just like humans, chimps are highly intelligent. They live in social groups, and just like humans, these groups have leaders.
Also like humans, chimps have a desire for power. In fact, chimpanzees have their own politics, which is surprisingly similar to human politics, as we'll be discovering in this programme.
Research shows that the reason chimpanzee behaviour so closely resembles human politics is because biologically we are almost identical. Did you know that a chimp is more like a human than like a gorilla? So Sam, my quiz question is this. Biologically, how close are chimpanzees to humans? Is it A, 79%, B, 89%, or C, 99%?
Well, Neil, if chimps and humans are almost identical, I'll guess C, 99%.
Okay, Sam, we'll find out the correct answer at the end of the programme. In human societies, of course, not everyone gets to be a political leader. It's usually the most powerful or ambitious person who becomes president.
In chimpanzee society, this is called the alpha male, the most successful and powerful male who leads the group.
Professor Franz De Waal is an expert on chimpanzee behaviour. Here he is on BBC World Service programme The Y Factor, telling presenter James Tilley about one example of chimp behaviour which closely mirrors human politics.
Older males who are over the hill and cannot be alpha male anymore, they start grooming a certain young male who they think has a future, and they may end up making that young male the alpha male with their help, meaning that they are essential to the power of that young male.
But they're the power behind the throne, really.
Yeah, these older males, and you see that in human politics all the time, these older males who have a lot of influence still.
Professor De Waal calls chimps who are too old to be alpha males over the hill, a phrase describing someone who is old and no longer useful or attractive.
Older chimps try to control younger males in order to maintain their own power and influence. In other words, they are the power behind the throne, an expression meaning someone with no official power but who secretly controls things in the background.
Another example of chimp politics is when several weaker males gang up and overthrow a stronger alpha male. By working together, weaker chimps can increase their power and the benefits, like food, which power brings.
According to Simon Hicks, professor of political science at the London School of Economics, human alliances work in exactly the same way.
Here is Professor Hicks speaking with BBC World Service programme The Y Factor.
So, for example, if you imagine three parties in a parliament, one big one and two small ones, you might think that naturally the most likely coalition is the big party with either one of the two small ones. Whereas, in fact, a minimum winning coalition prediction would suggest the two smaller ones should get together if together they can reach more than 50% of the seats, because they can divide up the spoils between the two of them. Whereas if either one of them formed a coalition with the big party would dominate and they wouldn't get many of the spoils for themselves.
Professor Hicks recommends that smaller political parties get together, join together in a group to combine their power.
These smaller parties could form a coalition, a collection of different political groups who unite for a limited time to form a government.
In human politics, making coalitions improves your chances of winning an election.
And in chimpanzee politics, coalitions are a good way for young male chimps to defeat the alpha male and divide up the spoils between themselves. Here, the word spoils means the benefits obtained by winning a war or being in a strong position.
For ambitious alpha chimps, the spoils might include getting first choice of food and female partners.
While for human politicians, power can bring wealth and fame as well.
And there's something else alpha chimpanzees and human politicians have in common. They like to show off their softer side by kissing babies.
It looks like chimps and humans share many similar behaviours after all. Which reminds me of your quiz question, Neil.
Yes, in my quiz question, I asked Sam how similar we are to chimps. What did you say, Sam?
I said that biologically speaking, we're C, 99% the same.
Which is the correct answer. Well done, Sam. You are as clever as a chimp.
Thanks, Neil. And you're definitely not over the hill. Let's recap the vocabulary from today's programme about chimp politics, starting with alpha male, the most successful and powerful male in any group.
Over the hill is used to describe someone who is old and no longer useful or attractive.
Someone who is the power behind the throne, secretly controls things, but has no official power.
Get together means join together as a group.
A coalition is when different political groups temporarily unite to form a government.
And finally, the spoils are benefits or advantages gained by winning a war.
And that's all for this programme. Bye for now.
Goodbye.
6 Minute English from BBC Learning English.